For airports, improving customer satisfaction is important, though also competitive and expensive. Lucky for Logan, it has a strong player on its team.
And we are talking, of course, about clam chowder. But let's back up because we're getting a little bit ahead of ourselves.
The top concern in the J.D. Power Airport Satisfaction Survey is the terminal tolerable.
The building itself, how clean is it? How do I interact with it? Is there access to things while I'm waiting for my aircraft? Is there enough seating?
Number two, getting there, an Achilles heel for Logan.
You don't have much time to decide once you come out of the tunnel where you're going to be. So, and I'm sure there's a lot of people who do that big loop, especially here in Boston. You'll find that occasionally a parking lot will close and then you got to go find the next parking lot. That's an access issue. They're doing a lot of things at Boston to alleviate that. They all know that's a problem.
TSA security, another critical part of the experience, as is check-in.
In fact, that's the highest rated part of the airport experience now because a lot of it's self-service now. You know, you're doing it on your phone, you're doing it at the kiosk, you're tagging your own bag and putting it on the belt and away it goes.
And here's the deal breaker.
The food, beverage, and retail program is what puts the good airports into the great airport category. And that is basically, do I have a sense of place? If I'm coming to Boston, I want to see those things I would only get in Boston. When I'm in Boston, boy, I'll have lunch at Legal Seafood because I can't find that in Indianapolis or Chicago.
Legal Seafoods began serving passengers at Logan in 1994. Today it runs six restaurants, the newest in Terminal E.
I think we were probably the first independent restaurant to come to open in an airport.
Back then, Roger Berkowitz had misgivings.
And I'm thinking, okay, well, airports have mediocre food. They have high prices, maybe not something I want to be associated with. But the airport authority, to their credit, in retrospect, was relentless. They kept, you know, hounding me, give it a try, give it a shot. And we did. A few months into it, I said, well, you know, this is kind of interesting because the traveler going through the airport has discretionary income and really discernible taste. So it's been a great sort of learning laboratory with us. And we know that we have sort of a really focused clientele here. We have more regulars at airports than almost any other place.
Legal's restaurants stay open until 30 minutes before the last departure, even when there are delays. And all, except for Terminal E, serve breakfast.
We make a really mean lobster and crab omelet. And it was really funny because one day I was about to get on a flight and a woman who didn't know what I did turned around and looked at me and said, if I were you, I'd order the lobster and crab omelet and take it on the plane with you. And I said, well, thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Cafes and gift shops were foreign notions when Boston got its first airfield in 1923. Today, Logan moves 105,000 people a day on 1,100 flights. It is a virtual city with a workforce of 17,000, its own fire department and state police unit. Terminal C, the oldest, is home to JetBlue, Logan's largest carrier. Norbert Strissel, director of airport operations for JetBlue.
We're just over 150 daily flights out of Boston. Starting this May, we start nonstop service to Minneapolis. That'll bring us 65 nonstop destinations.
That's up from just five when the startup with its no-frill flights first landed here in 2004. Today, JetBlue's futuristic terminal reflects its growth.
We looked at it as an opportunity to, if anything, make it our own. More of a self-service, open environment. A lot of kiosks, a lot of flow space. Customers can help themselves self-tagging. At the same time, we still have full service for those that just need a little extra help.
And recently, a new class of service. JetBlue is going green. Mint green on cross-country flights. Ryan Kermeens explains.
This is spectacular. Tell me what you guys have done here.
Well, JetBlue's new version of what we would consider first class, we are at JetBlue are calling it Mint.
Mint amenities include lie-flat seats.
Originally, the market started just on the LA route. It's now grown into almost five cities, leaving Boston to the West Coast.
We can actually lie-flat, so what button do we press?
So here, you would want to
stand by.
You just say one.
Keep going, this is perfect. Wake me when we get there.
Yeah.
Off to San Diego.
Good night.
Oh, that certainly looked cozy.
It was cozy.
And it's been reported that, pending final approval, that is, that JetBlue will have a weekly nonstop flight to Havana, Cuba in the future.
Yeah, and that's tremendous. And one of the reasons the Department of Transportation says that it'll likely be granted is because, of course, Boston is home to tremendous healthcare institutions, tremendous biotechnology firms, and, of course, all of our educational institutions. The same reasons most people want to come here to Boston, and Cubans want to do that as well. So they're hoping to have that open relatively soon.
That would be terrific. This dog is trained to track bombs. This is Quiver, the explosive detection canine.